So as you're coming in, we got a little while till we begin. If you're part of Unity, there's that survey in the bulletin. This is your chance to fill it out, turn it in afterwards.
Thank you. Like this rose to the choir, I'm preaching to the choir.
Okay, you recruited us. This will be a preaching to the right choir.
That's what I said. This gives new meaning to speaking to the preaching to the choir, right?
Do you speak any other languages, Rollin?
I'm sorry?
Do you speak any other languages?
No, I actually have a hard time with English.
I figured that out already.
That's enough right there.
I'm sorry?
That's a duck right there. We can only perfect English. What would the world be like?
So you speak what?
Azerbaijani. Which is Azerbaijani. It's a country near Iran and Russia.
Okay.
It's Azeri is the name of every language. Okay. And Farsi.
I haven't
either.
So
it's beautiful. And Farsi.
Oh, Farsi. So not Arabic? Arabic?
No.
So Farsi. So Farsi is what?
4,000 years old.
No, but I mean what countries? So I think
Afghanistan. Yes.
So one of my books is being translated in the Farsi by the Minister of Health of Afghanistan.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I gotta get into it.
Yeah, so. Okay. I know, that was really cool. He came to an event. I'll talk about it today, the event we do in Mexico.
So hi, everybody. Welcome.
Shows up and he goes, you know, I saw that they were from Afghanistan. Who are you? I'm the Minister of Health. They love you. It's cool.
It's the law of the universe.
So he's been teaching heart math to the president.
Great to have everybody here. Take that deep breath through your heart. Put your hand there. Make that connection. Deep breath through your heart as we go into this amazing experience of understanding the heart in ways that we may have not have had a glimpse of before. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with Unity, I'm David MacArthur, I'm the community minister here. And with us today is Dr. Rollin McCraty. Rollin is the director of research at the HeartMath Institute. And for those of you that are aware of HeartMath, it is his wonderful research that is really behind the amazing discoveries and so much of the research now is, as the world has been processing and heading into seeking to understand and take to the next level the breakthroughs that HeartMath has been able to do. So, and Rollin is also the director for the research with the Global Coherent Initiative, which going to get a chance to learn about today. So wonderful things, and some of you got to tag in with him at the service and look at some of those initial explorations, and we're just thrilled to have him here with us. So help me welcome Rollin.
Thank you. Great to have you here.
Thank you, my friend. And just a reminder, I'll remind you later, but we just ran out of the books.
Did we?
Never mind.
Oh,
okay.
I bought it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, so, we can send more.
We'll get more. So you can sign up for those and everything afterwards. But,
Well, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thanks for spending your time with me today. So the presentation that I'm going to talk about today is relevant to the Global Coherence Initiative. So I'm not going to be talking about earlier work and more fundamental work in some ways, which is how the heart and heart coherence and heart-brain communication and the physiology of all that. So that's a very different thing. So that's not what I'm talking about today. So hopefully that's okay with everybody. So GCI is the acronym for Global Coherence Initiative, the science of human Earth and human interaction and interconnectivity. How many of you are just curious, are already familiar with GCI to a certain degree? Wow, a lot of you. Not all of you, but a lot of you. Cool. So GCI, there's really two main halves. One is really public education, membership, really helping people feed the field, as we'll talk about later, more positive energy and all that. And so there's a little over 200,000 people involved now, in one way or another, on the membership side. That's great. But we really need that, because without the people doing that, we don't have anything to measure on the research side. So I'm going to talk more about the research side today than the other side. Some of you may not know, this is our mission statement for HeartMath Institute. And I'll show you the mission statement for GCI in a few minutes. But we really are about helping, developing tools and techniques and processes for helping people bring their physical, mental, and emotional systems into kind of coherent or energetic alignment with the heart's intuitive guidance. That's really what we're about. So, and always have been. And that really unfolds the path or the connection to unfold who we really are at our deeper core level. So that's kind of interesting.
Hand in hand.
It really does. I see now. I'm just pointing like up there. Okay, so we talked a little bit about this for some of you that were here this morning, one of the services, about David had asked me some questions about local field connections. And we've done a number of studies in our laboratory over the years that really show that when we're in a more heart coherent state, that we radiate a more coherent field, and that effects that can be detected by the nervous system of other people and actually in a measurable way affect other people and animals and our beloved pets and so on. I'm going to show you a few examples of that, and then we'll expand this to the global level. So when you go to the doctor and they put electrodes across your chest, right, they're measuring the electrocardiogram. Right? Mm-hmm. Why is it called the electrocardiogram? What are we measuring? Electricity, right? So when you put electrodes, whether it's on your brain or your heart, across your heart, you are measuring a current flow. And the heart generates by far the largest source of rhythmic current flows in the body. But whenever you have a flow of current, see how many of you remember your middle school physics here? Pretty basic. When you have a flow of current, you create a magnetic field, right? So magnetic fields, we call it electromagnetism, but actually electric fields and magnetic fields are two very different things. They are not the same, one and the same. That gets kind of confused because it's called electromagnetism, but you can make one out of the other, right? So whenever you have a flow of current, you make magnetic fields. So we measure the current flow. I'm missing a slide, that's okay. But anyway, it's on the first slide. Back to that. So that donut shape, that kind of toroidal shape, is actually the shape of the magnetic field produced by the heart. It actually is that shape. This is not real data, but it's a toroidal shape. Looks just like the magnetic field of the Earth or the Sun. Same shape, just so it's field within fields. So it's a very complex kind of spiraling field. And that the magnetic field is the thing that radiates outside of us. So magnetic fields are different. It's very easy to block or shield electric fields. You know, things called Faraday cages and that kind of thing. Magnetic fields are a different story. They're almost impossible to block or shield. Especially the lower frequency ones like we're talking about. So, okay, so why does this thing work inside of a building? It's the magnetic component that goes out and talks to the cell tower. So a lot of what I'm going to be talking about is actually this is a really good parallel. Because we know a lot about magnetic fields. My previous life, well, I don't really mean past life, but previous life, this time around. I used to work for Motorola as a communication engineer. So I know a little bit about these things, right? So we know a lot about how to use magnetic fields to carry information, right? The text, the picture, phone call. I mean, that's, we're using a magnetic field to carry that information from my phone, the cell tower, and so on. So what I'm really, make everything I'm going to talk about today really simple, is that we work the same way. Okay? So the magnetic field created by the heart is carrying information, especially about our emotional states. In fact, we use, it's called spectral analysis. Same thing I would use if I, or used to use when I wanted to know what the information on the magnetic field there was. We can do the same thing with these fields we measure from the heart. In fact, that's what you're looking at up here in the monitor. These are spectrums of the heart's magnetic field when people are in two different emotional states. So you can see frustration over on, I guess it's on your, I'm directionally dyslexic, so you might have to on your left, and on the right is when, what it tends to look like when somebody's feeling deep, sincere appreciation. And I use underlying feeling, because thoughts don't do this. Very big difference between the concept of something, the thinking it, and actually feeling, the genuine feeling of, say, like appreciation or compassion or kindness. Okay, so we can measure this stuff. Oops, gotta get this thing pointed the right way here. Okay. So basically what I'm suggesting here is these magnetic fields are carrying this information, and you're sitting in each other's fields right now. Naturally, and that does have measurable impacts. So how many of you had the experience go into a friend's house, or it could even be a place of business? Before you catch any body language cues or tones of voice, you just have this sense that, something doesn't feel right. Right? A lot of sayings for this, right? You could feel the, could cut the tension in the air with a knife. Right? Lots of sayings in our language that describe this. On the other hand, you can be around somebody or in an environment that just feels uplifting and really good. Right? So that's really what those two graphs I just showed you are about. So it's just kind of showing that we really do affect each other energetically. Why does it keep? Okay, for some reason it always wants to go one back. Anyway, so a fun way to demonstrate this. This is my son Josh and his dog Mabel. Yeah, he was 12 when this picture was taken. So this is how long I've been doing this. He's 30 now. Oh, wow. Yeah, I need a T-shirt. I survived puberty. Anyway, so being family members made him automatic research subjects. Didn't need, some of you in the research world, no IRBs required, things like that. It's kind of pain in the room. Anyway, so what we did is we brought, had Josh bring his dog over to the lab, Mabel, and we put recorders on both him and the dog that record their heart rate variability, the beat-to-beat change in heart rate. That's a whole other topic, but their heart rhythms, you just call it. So the one on top is Mabel, and you can see over on the far, okay, you gotta help me here, left side. Mabel's rhythms are all over the place. She's all excited because she's in a lab that's off limits normally, so she's sniffing around, having a good time exploring. Josh is on the bottom, and he's told to go in and not to interact with Mabel, no touching, talking, just sit down quietly and do, I'm sure most of you here probably know what a heart lock-in is, right? So he did a heart lock-in and radiated love and all that to Mabel. And lucky you don't have a pointer here, so. Lucky, and you see over here, Josh went into a pretty coherent state. I'd say lucky, because he better not do this stuff. he did, but look what happened to Mabel up on top. A lot of you might have seen this before. So this is, again, an energetic effect. There's no physical touching. Same thing with Ellen and Tonopah, horses and people and corrals. Same thing when it's in a corral. So the line on the bottom, the red, is the horse. And the, on top is Ellen, in this case, doing a heart lock-in. So you can see the pretty dramatic change in the horse's HRV there. Anybody see that? So this is an experiment that worked better than it should have. So it really did. It was the first time this was done, it was done with four horses. And three out of the four had almost identical, very clear shifts and almost identical patterns that you see here. One horse didn't. And I found out later, we were kind of blind, you know, being popular research. But anyway, the one horse that had no change at all, no shift, was well known for having a personality that didn't want anything to do with humans. Pretty standoff, kind of leave me alone kind of horse that didn't have the shift. Now, this has since been replicated at the University of Arizona, you know, very formally and extended and all that, so it's a very real cool finding. Here's mothers and babies. Talk about that a little bit. A little different method now, getting more scientific here, if you will. So this is a process called signal averaging. Not that you need to know what that is, but it's a technique for determining if two signals from very distinct places have any kind of synchronized activity between them. So the blue line on top is mom's brain waves after it's gone through this signal averaging process. And the bottom, the red, is baby's heartbeat, electrocardiogram. So again, there's no physical contact here. This is, again, an energetic experiment. And what we see, that form of the blue line, see how it dips down and right with the baby's red line? Heartbeats. This is a literal measurement of synchronization between mom's brain waves and the baby's heartbeats. No physical contact. And this is actually modulated by mom's attention. As mom paid more attention, focused her attention, you were asking about attention earlier. Another example. So in this case, by focus, putting my awareness on the baby or you, I come more in sync with you. If we block, you know, mom distracted her, went off thinking about other stuff, then the degree of this synchronization was reduced. Okay, this is kind of a complicated looking graph. I apologize for that, but I'll just tell you what it means. This is the same thing, signal averaging, from two adults that are 5 feet apart. Now, you might have heard me mention earlier, we can measure the magnetic field about 3 feet. That's with a $50,000 piece of equipment. Right, so our nervous systems are far more sensitive to magnetic fields. And so at least we're all worth at least 50 grand.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Now, our nervous systems are very tuned in to other biological signals. A lot of people ask me about, well, what about 60 hertz? No, it's really, we're very narrow windows. What we're tuned into is the rhythms and frequencies we operate at. Make sense? So we're exquisitely sensitive to other people's heart rhythms and heartbeats. So in other words, even at conversational distances, we see heart-brain synchronization going on between people.
What's the circle, please?
The circle just helps you for people. This graph just, some people hate scientific graphs and don't understand them. So the circle's there to show you, if you see when this two different people, remember, 5 feet apart. So one person's heartbeat goes up, just how synchronous and then the shift in the brain waves are. I mean, this is amazing to see this level of physiological coupling going on at those kind of distances. So these very weak signals in a way when you think about it. Okay, I mentioned this earlier for those that are one of the services to the study here. This is a study that was done, independent study, where I took 40 people and divided them into small subgroups. So three of them, well, they were put four people at a time, got around a table, small table. Three of them had been trained only 2 weeks earlier in how to shift into a heart coherent state. I know I haven't talked about what that is, but the sine wave heart rhythm patterns that are associated with love and compassion and care and so on. And then the fourth person didn't have a clue what this was all about. Okay, so they'd had 2 weeks training to be able to shift into coherence and sustain it. And the experiment was asking, okay, when these three people are randomly signaled, you know, in a whole method they had worked out to shift into a coherent state and then do other things, read a book, in and out, what happens to the fourth person when the three people are in a coherent state? So what do you think happened? We'll see if you can read slides or not. Became more coherent, yes. All right, you can start. Yeah, exactly. In other words, when we're in a coherent field environment, it literally has a measurable effect on lifting us into, even at a physiological level, into more coherence. So what? Well, hello.
Is it Jeff?
Hmm? So So why might this be important? Because this is what we have to interact now. You have to talk to them. Why would this be relevant?
Isn't it contagious in a sense?
Okay. Yeah, I think it is contagious. I'm really bottom line saying our especially emotions, much more than anything else, are affecting other people all the time. Bad organ, by the way. Okay, yeah.
Say you had a meeting of a lot of heads of state and so on, mm-hmm. and you could get the majority of them to sit in coherence. Mm-hmm. Then that should affect the people that yeah. weren't.
That's a great example. That's why I was asking you the question. Yeah, so, So what if one of our friends or colleagues is having a hard day? What's one of the best things we can do to help them get back to balance sooner? Right, versus getting all sympathy and, you poor thing, and right, which just gets us down in the same kind of thing. Right, or if you're somebody who interacts with clients, in almost any kind of profession, you have to interact with people. Right? Maintaining our coherence can have that lifting effect on others, yeah.
We did some surveys here in the fall for this church, and a number of people hadn't been here very long, mm-hmm. they were thinking about what attracted them, and they said, I walked in the doors and I knew I belonged. Mm-hmm.
They felt something, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's now move it to, we'll take it from the living room level, what Ben talking about, to, yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Let's talk about that. The next segment where I'm going. Thank you. So this is the mission statement for GCI. I can't see the moniker up there in the sun, so I apologize. Basically, it's a science-based project. It's a very, very collaborative, a lot of collaborators around the world. We got collaborated with NASA, for example, University of Lithuania. Just talked to some folks at Harvard University yesterday. We have a lot of collaborative stuff going on. But anyway, it's really about helping unite people in heart-focused care and intention to facilitate the global shift. And I really mean the global shift in consciousness that's going on. That's what the shift is all about. But from instability and discord, which is its current state, we want a more enduring peace and balance. So here's our high-level scientific hypotheses, what they're called. That really guide the different research studies. So the first one is not really a hypothesis, this is quite well established, and that is that our emotions, health, and behaviors are affected by the activity in the Earth's magnetic field environment, planetary energetic fields. So there's a surprising amount of research showing that it's not really a hypothesis anymore. The second one is a little stretchy for some, but more and more data supporting this, and that is that the Earth's magnetic field acts as a carrier of biologically relevant, and I'll say patterned information, that really connects all living systems. We don't live in the magnetic field of the Earth, right? I mean, you can't escape it. Right? Not just us, but all animals, trees, plants, we all live within that field. And basically, what I'm going to be suggesting here is we're all directly connected to that field, and thus all interconnected and really leads to what we call a global information field.
So are you saying there is no confidentiality?
Well, if you're tuned in enough, there's no secrets.
Say that again.
Said if you're really tuned in enough to this, there's no secrets. Okay, so large numbers of people creating heart-centered states of love, care, compassion, right, what we're feeding the field, is what we're talking about. That helps generate a more coherent field environment that affects all other living systems within the larger field. By the way, that's going on whether we like it or not. Yep. So the inverse is also true. I talked about this in services. If we're feeding the field a lot of anger or anxiety, that's what we're feeding the field as well, which is the current state of discord. And, mm-hmm. Right? And the media, of course, whips it all up. So this is a statement by a guy that a lot of you probably never heard of, Franz Hallberg. And he's basically saying it's clear that invisible magnetic forces from the sun and Earth affect life on Earth from actually before birth until death. Anybody ever heard of Franz from Dr. Holman? Okay, Pam, go ahead. How many of you know the term circadian rhythm?
Yes.
Everybody, right? So Dr. Hallberg is the man who coined the term circadian rhythm. He when it first came up with it and introduced it in 1948. And Dr. Hallberg just passed away about a year ago, a little over a year ago. So he was up till 96, I think, and worked every day, right up until that time. The father of what's the field of chronobiology called. Chrono, meaning time. And it became clear to him pretty early on that once he understood circadian rhythms and how important they are to all living systems, not just humans, but animals, plants, everything, that the rhythms weren't just synchronized to and affected by photons, day-night cycles, but by the invisible magnetic fields in the sun and earth. He's done many, many studies showing that lots of things, a lot of these studies were originally done, started by him, in fact, that these are well-established things, that the activity in our brain and nervous system is synchronized to and affected by the magnetic field environment of the Earth, how well we perform on a lot of tasks, our blood pressure. In fact, our blood pressure and heart rhythms also can actually be synchronized to your fields. Number of traffic violations. And accidents ride right along with your fields. Lots and lots of studies on health statistics. So admissions to hospitals for heart disease, stroke, just big, lots and lots of data on that. Arrhythmias, criminal activity, terrorism, attacks, frequency, all ride the same rhythms. Now, the first guy to do, yeah.
Can I ask a quick question? Does this interface with
biorhythms? Sure. Yeah, well, you can call heart rhythms and all biorhythms if you want to.
Well, I mean, biorhythms, historically, you've been around for a long time.
Yeah, let me.
A lot of research has been done in that area.
Yeah, give me one slide. I think maybe I'll answer your question. Can I hear? Okay, so the first real modern guy to do research on this stuff is this guy. He's a Russian astrophysicist, Alexander Chesovsky. And he got drafted into World War I. And being an astrophysicist, he was keeping one eye on what the solar activity was in the sun. And it appeared to him that when you had a lot of solar flares and a lot of solar activity, that people down here on Earth just got stupid. This got him intrigued. So after the war, he did an exhaustive study of human history. Amazing what these guys pulled off before we had internets. Very, very rigorous work. The next graph I'm going to show you is his original data. It's from his original data, just to honor where this all came from. And at the end of all this, he created what he called his index of mass human excitability.
Wow.
Okay. So take a look at these graphs. The blue line on top, if we start on top, way over here, that is 1749. And then we go years wrapping around to the bottom to 1926 when this was first published. Now what's being plotted by the blue line is there's a dot each year for the number of major human events that occurred during that year. Okay, big things, global effects, revolutions, onsets of wars. He did it to disease as well, yes. Plagues and things like that, yeah. The red line on the bottom is the solar cycle for the same time period.
Wow.
So solar cycle actually leads a little bit before the blue.
Yeah, a little bit, but they're pretty
smart.
When you're looking at yearly levels, it's but in reality, if you look at a more fine grain, yes. But so the solar cycle is about a 10 and a half to 11 year cycle. So you think there might be a correlation there?
No.
No, right. Don't confuse me with the data. My mind's made up.
This is Steve Jobs, guy.
it's kind of, it's pretty profound, actually. When I first learned of this, it's like, what? Why don't we know? Why does nobody know about this?
Just to be clear, you said magnetic fields cannot be shielded, blocked off.
There's only one place on Earth I know of that can actually block magnetic, low frequency magnetic fields.
They can't. So I was thinking, if we knew this as fact that we didn't want war, we could have tried to block it off.
So
you're telling me that we can't block. We don't have the technology yet.
Well, you wouldn't necessarily want to anyway.
Why not?
Well. Okay, I'll cover.
For an experiment.
Yeah, well,
just to see what happens.
Okay, so the experiments that have been done where you put animals in a magnetically shielded environment, it does not turn out well for them.
They lose their own.
Yeah, they die.
They die. Oh, that's right.
Okay. We want to be coupled.
Yeah.
Okay, so, in fact, I was given this very similar presentation in Saudi Arabia a few years ago, and somebody raised their hand and said, can't we just lock up all the politicians for that 2 years? So I think that's a more sane approach to trying to shield ourselves. Let's just lock up the, right? Put them on timeout for a couple of years. Yeah.
Rollin, where is that one place you said that you can shield?
The one place that you can shield is in Berlin. And it's a multi-million dollar facility that has 7 layers of rooms built within rooms, built within rooms, a very expensive new middle and all this stuff.
Have you visited?
I haven't visited, but a friend of mine's here right now, so I'm doing some experiments.
Why does it exist?
Well, to do experiments in magnetic and shielded environments.
Atomic warheads information.
Yes.
When you see a low coming, are there enough people now to do a test to see if everybody focuses and gets into coherence? If it affects what happens when the sun...
We're getting there. But before we go there, because this might sound like I'm trying to say that the sun and the sun is out to get us. It's not that way. And I need to underline this slide, what's being said here, and put a neon sign around it. Okay, it is true that during the peaks of the solar cycles, right, there's more onsets of war and all that stuff. It's also the greatest periods of human flourishing. More
consciousness.
Well, scientific discoveries, if you look historically, more major discoveries, the flourishing of the arts, the great artists that come up with new music and scientific discoveries and on and on. Globally. Okay? So a way to think of this.
And lifespan.
Well, I'm not sure about lifespan. Because we're talking cycles here, 10-year cycles now. I'm going to go off track here, but there is a correlation there, but it's different. So during an increased solar period, cycle period, the sun is literally putting out more energy. Mm-hmm. Literally, in certain UV spectrums and radio frequencies and all the stuff. So that's an energetic influx to the planet, to all the planets within the sun's magnetic field, including Earth. So that interacts with our magnetic field, the Earth, and eventually couples down into us. So just think of it as an energy influx during these increased periods. So what it really gets down to is how mature are we? What do you choose or unconsciously? So most people aren't conscious of this, but there's these energy influxes. So how do we use it? Do we use it to develop new friendships, collaborations, cooperation, or do we use it to, go do silly things? Get in traffic accidents, more energy, more traffic accidents, like you said, or if you're a politician, go start wars. Well, seriously, all amped up how big and screwy and all that that goes on.
Ego.
Yeah. It pumps up the ego if you don't have the self-regulation and the management. Yes. Yeah, I have. Nobody's looked at how the pole's shifting. It hadn't happened in 620,000 years, so. we know it happens, but it's on a time scale that's so. I don't wake up in the morning and worry about what's going to happen with the pole shift. Not that it couldn't happen, right? Because we're overdue. But that's another. You get my point here, right?
Yes.
The sun's not out to get us, right? It's really what we do. So the way, in an immature world, emotionally speaking, the way this, these energetic influxes hit most people is through their emotional system. And this is actually a statement that came from a study we did with 1,600 people, GCI members, a few years ago, where we tracked over a six-month period. I won't go into details. Basically, when the Earth's magnetic field is disturbed, people are more mentally fogged and confused, quicker to be frustrated, impatient,
judgmental,
irritated, all that stuff, yeah, anxious, don't sleep as well, wake up feeling kind of edgy, wrong side of bed, you know. Anybody ever experienced that? You know, some mornings you wake up, you didn't have any issues with anybody, you just wake up feeling out of sync and kind of off. We all that'll have, right?
Depends if it's a full moon.
Well, full moon is the faster, subtler cycle, but yeah. But these are real energetic way that manifests. So if we're going to do research, we've got to measure this stuff. So we're listening in on the Earth's energetic systems. And to do that, we installed these magnetometers, called the actual magnetometers. I'll show you some pictures of what their sites look like in a minute. It's called the Global Coherence Monitoring System. Eventually, we would like to have 12 to 14 sites. Right now, there are 6 that are active and installed. And see if I can remember where. Canada, California, here at our location. South Africa, Lithuania, Saudi Arabia, and New Zealand.
Why not Mexico?
Just haven't got one there yet.
Oh.
Actually, I want Brazil. And Equator is where we'd like to go next. Okay, so this is what the one in Boulder Creek looks like at our facility. And they've got to be kind of really isolated so you don't have a lot of man-made noise getting in the way of what we're measuring. But some of you may have actually been to our, anybody have been there and seen this? A few of you? A lot of you, you know. Okay.
Do they have public tours?
If you're there as part of an event or something, yes. This is the one in Saudi Arabia. But you see, you might notice this big block, cement block wall.
Yeah. Of course, it's not to trample them.
Yeah.
I heard an interview.
Okay, you heard it. Yeah. So basically, Dr. Abdallah, who was at that time was the head of a large cardiac hospital, he's been there with, he's now moved on to greater things. But anyway, he was telling me on the phone, we have to build this block wall. Sorry, I got you this short again. Anyway, I kept arguing with him. No, we don't need a block wall. The magnetometers are underground. Everything's cool. No, we need a block wall. I never asked him why. I learned my lesson. Turns out the desert is full of free-ranging camels who do like to roll on things and scratch themselves. And also we have these sand drift issues. So in fact, the wall's well over my head. And they've had to bring in big, heavy equipment twice now to remove the sand. I used to live in Palm Springs, you know, the desert. Thought I know desert living. No. It's a whole different story. So anyway, this is one of my many trips to Saudi Arabia now, and fellow in the center is the fellow that owns the land where the site is, what site is. And this is, I'll tell you, every site, when you install it, has its own story. I'm not going to go through all of them and tell you all the stories, but there's another unique one. This was in South Africa. And our sensor sites get to live in some pretty cool places. And this one's on a 10,000-acre game park. You know, a protected game park, so you've got all the critters running around. And first time I'd actually been to Africa, so it's really fun to see the zebras and giraffes and running around wild, you know. So anyway, we get our site installed, and there's tubes like you saw in the last picture, maybe coming up out of the ground. And the park manager, who keeps crowds of the games, comes driving up to see how we're doing, looks down and says, "Boys, bam, there's elephant toys." They love to pull things out of the ground. So we spent the next day, emergency, blank, off to the store to build this little block wall over the sensors to elephant-proof the sensor sites. And then, lo and behold, here's some of the elephants on the reserve. You can see a little some babies back in the back there. So that was pretty cool.
For the locations that you choose? You mentioned its longitude.
Well, it's geography.
Okay.
where we want them. You can't always get it perfect because you have oceans where you really want one. And then at a practical level, they got to be somewhere far enough away from roads and buildings and people stuff that you don't, yeah, isolated places that yet have power. Have power.
Electricity.
Oh, okay. Yeah, ideally. Saudi Arabia is 100 kilometers from anywhere, out in the middle of the desert, and it's solar powered, and it's a real pain in the butt, to be quite honest. Yes, yeah, weekly somebody's got to clean the solar panels off, and it's a maintenance nightmare compared to, you know, the power. All right, so what are we talking about anyway? All this magnetic field stuff. So this is kind of a nice idealized picture of what the Earth's magnetic field is like. It's actually a lot more complex, but it's basically you have a north pole and a south pole, and the magnetic field is basically a static field or stationary field, like a refrigerator magnet. You know, a magnet, a physical magnet that sticks on a refrigerator is a pure magnetic field. There's no electric field there. Right? And it's static. It's stable. What static means is it's stationary. It's always there. It's not changing in strength. And that's what the Earth's field is like. Yes, it changes in strength, but it's over thousands of years. It's not, you know, like for our day-to-day lives, we don't need to worry about the magnetic field changing. Right? But it's like this. So remember, it radiates out into space thousands of miles, many thousands of miles, hundreds of thousands of miles. And thank God for magnetic field, because it's what shields Earth from all the stuff we need to be shielded from. So if we didn't have a magnetic field, Earth would turn into Mars very quickly. No atmosphere, no water, no life as we know it. So let's all appreciate that we have a magnetic field. All right, back to science class. Remember back when you got to pour iron filings on a glass plate and you put a magnet under it? You kind of tap it and they all magically line up and... y'all did that, right? Yeah. I'm sorry? Okay. All right, yeah, okay, yeah. Anyway, so they lined up in lines, right? It wasn't just gradated kind of equal thing. There's lines they all line up to. That's kind of what these white lines are representing here. Those are called flux lines. They're real things. They got little electrons spinning them around and all this kind of stuff. So think of the Earth, even though the field strength isn't ringing or changing or modulating. Think of these field lines like guitar strings. And what happens when you pluck a guitar string? Vibrates. You change the tension on the string, and what happens? The frequency, the note, the pitch changes. Well, as it turns out, the Earth's magnetic field lines are doing exactly that. They're big guitar strings. And they're being plucked by the solar wind. So the solar wind is the stuff, not the photons, the day and night stuff, being blown out of the sun. And it's these staggering, it's kind of hard to even put your head around with these numbers. I don't know what they are anyway. But it's gazillions of tons per second of stuff being blown out by the sun. Okay, high energy protons and plasma waves and all this stuff. That's what makes up the solar wind. On a nice quiet day, the solar wind is traveling at about 1,000,000 miles per hour. It can jump up to 5 million if you have a lot of solar flares and stuff going on. The solar wind has enough pressure that it pushes in the Earth's magnetic field, that's the blue stuff there on the slide, on the daytime side and stretches it out on the nighttime side. All stuff we learned back in high school and promptly forgot, at least I did. Meanwhile, the Earth is turning, so is the sun. Right, so the solar wind is rushing by and it's plucking the strings, the magnetic field. And some new satellites, this is brand new, this is within just a few months. This is actual real data from these new satellites whose mission is to study the Earth's magnetic field. So this isn't an artistic thing, this is actual real data. Right, so that's the Earth right there, that little dot, and then up there again. So what you're seeing here is an actual visualization of the ringing of the Earth's magnetic field lines.
Did you say ringing?
Ringing.
Oh, whoa.
Plucking the strings.
Wow.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah, cool.
Right? And these are called field line resonances. By the way, if you're interested in the science term, you want to Google it or something.
And that pitch you were talking about, Rollin, how does that fit into that diagram there?
Good question. I'm glad you asked. Yes, how does the pitch? So if we measure the frequency of these, this is a spectrum from our magnetometers. We find that one of the, and these are big, and I'll show you a picture of them in a second. But one of the primary common frequencies is this first peak you see here on this graph. That is at a frequency called 0.1 hertz. Okay? That is exactly the same frequency. These are human heart rhythms when you're in a coherent state. 0.1 hertz. Okay? So Earth is vibrating at exactly the same frequency as our heart rhythms when we're in a coherent state. But even if we're not coherent, it's still the same rhythm. So all of those frequencies that they modulate through and around, depending upon all these dynamics, how tight the strings are and the solar wind pressure, and all are in the region of our heart rhythms and nervous system rhythms. Yes?
So I have a question. What came first, the Earth's heart rhythm or ours?
Well, I'd say Earth was probably around a lot longer than we were.
That's a billion-dollar question here. Yeah.
In fact, Dr. Hallberg suggests in his latter years, he actually was a close friend of mine, even published some papers together, that we have the rhythms encoded into our genetics that we do because we evolved in the rhythms of the Earth. Makes sense, doesn't it? I mean,
yeah.
But you kind of get what I just said, right?
Yes.
No, but there's other possibilities, but I'll leave it at that.
Okay. So the other set of magnetic waves that are of interest here are these waves that get trapped between the Earth and the ionosphere. So if you're not familiar with ionosphere, think of it as a big soap bubble around the planet. It starts about 50 miles up from the surface of the Earth, and it's about 100 to 150 miles thick, so relatively speaking, it's quite thin when you think of Earth-scale things, right? That's a little gray ring you see here. And the ionosphere, it's highly charged ions, hence ionosphere. It's what's called plasma, which in physics is the fourth state of matter. And plasmas have a lot of unique properties. We won't go into all that right now, but that are quite relevant in current flows. There are giant figure eight current flows that are going on above us right now and different things that are inducing currents into the Earth. But the thing relevant for this part of the discussion is the bottom of the ionosphere is like a mirror to magnetic waves. A lot of you are probably familiar with amateur or ham radio operators. The way that works is radio waves don't go through the Earth. So the way somebody in the U.S. talks to somebody in England or China, something like that, is that's little, by little squiggly lines. As you send your radio wave up, it hits the ionosphere and bounces off. That's how they, and if you're really lucky, you get a second bounce, right? So it bounces up and off. Now you're talking to somebody in South Africa or Australia or something. Live for that. I mean, that's, I'm serious. I mean, trade cards and all that. It's fun. But the reason that works is because of the ionosphere that we can bounce our magnetic waves off. So what this means is that anytime big magnetic waves get created in this cavity between the Earth and the ionosphere that have this, the right geometry, the right frequency, that are resonant, they become globally propagating standing waves. And those are called Schumann resonances. They're named after a guy, Otto Schumann, who was a German mathematician who predicted their existence. So they got named after him. And they were first experimentally measured in the very late 1950s, 1960, in there. So these, eight of them. And when we measure them, here's their frequencies. So the first one is 7.8 hertz, and it varies about a half hertz between day and night, kind of thing. Yeah, but anyway, there's eight of them. You see seven of them here. So 8, 7, 14, so on.
Wasn't the 7.8 frequency a mean frequency?
Well, he predicted it'd be 10 hertz. I mean, the math, but it's... No. The Schumann resonance, okay. So there's stuff on the internet that the Schumann resonant frequencies are increasing. I'm sorry to say it's utter nonsense. They are exactly the same as they were when they were first measured in 1960. No, the mean frequencies are exactly the same as they were in 1960.
But the mean frequency is not just 7.8.
Well, that is actually, 7.8 actually is the average when you do the average of the bird.
Yeah.
I mean, they've always varied around that. But mean, that is the mean frequency. What does change is the amplitude of the frequencies, especially the second harmonic. And it varies seasonably. So if you just do a short window, it looks like it's increasing, but you follow it long enough, it's got a rhythm, a seasonal rhythm. Okay? So some people have jumped the gun. And anyway, I just made that comment. That question would probably come up. Anyway, so 7.8 hertz, 14 hertz, 22 hertz. If you think of our physiology, what rhythms or frequencies inside of us is that anybody familiar with? You might think that would be.
What's the question?
Well, if we measure something in us humans, what are the same as those frequencies?
You mean like our brain?
Yeah, like our brain.
Beta,
beta, alpha. These are our brainwave frequencies.
Well,
low alpha. Depends on your system. A lot of people, they call it low alpha. Other people call it high theta. But it's a major brainwave frequency. 7.8 hertz.
Now, these Schumann frequencies, they're just natural?
Yeah.
Okay.
So they're globally, here's a science term for you, globally propagating standing waves. All that, we'll translate that. They're everywhere, all the time.
Okay,
now here's what, this is actual data that comes out of the different magnetometers. There's three different sites being shown here. And this, where is it? So it's California, New Zealand, and Canada. And you see those really big waves, right? Those are the field line resonances. That's the Earth's field lines vibrating, reflecting in the guitar strings. And you see that kind of, they look kind of noisy, right? So we're going to blow up the noise in this little block you see here. All right, that's the next line. That's the Schumann resonances. So I just wanted you to see the difference in magnitude of the field line resonances and the Schumann resonances. In other words, the vibrating field lines are really powerful compared to the Schumann resonances. Yeah, we've heard a lot about Schumann resonances for years. And the fact that they're the same as the brain waves. What about the heart? In the field line resonance, it's really more significant. But basically what we're seeing here is that Earth's two main systems, magnetic systems, overlap exactly our key physiological systems, heart and brain. So what? Right? So back to science class again. Middle school, high school, whatever it was, right? You probably know the answer. When do they teach it now? When do you get tuning forks out? What grade? It doesn't really matter.
It starts early.
It's probably really what it did for us.
Black holes
and concrete. Yeah, but I didn't hear about black holes even in high school, so right. Things are changing. For us, it was, I don't know, seventh grade, somewhere near. Tuning forks. Anyway, you bang a tuning fork, and the other tuning fork magically starts to vibrate. They're the same frequency, right? Resonance. It's also demonstrating a couple things, energetic or resonant coupling, is what it's really called. So one of the things they didn't teach us back in science class, it's absolutely true, is tuning forks are highly coherent systems. You can only have resonance when you have coherence. So in the case of our tuning forks, it was air molecules that mediate the energy exchange, but it's exactly the same way, magnetic fields work exactly the same way. They just don't need the air molecules. Back to our cell phone. All those cell calls are here now in the air, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do we get the one, how do we tune to the one we want? Anybody know?
Pay our bill.
Okay. Fair enough. Good answer. Other than paying our bill, the phone doesn't care about that. Right? We have to create a resonant, literally, we create a resonant frequency with the frequency of interest. We tune the receiver here. Once you have that resonant coupling, you transfer energy and information. These are weak fields. Carrying all circles or cell calls around. Way weaker than the nurse magnetic field. Effectively, you know. So we have to become resonant with. And when you're resonant with something, same frequency is all that means, is you transfer energy and information between them. Now what have I just said? We're the same frequency as Earth. Exactly. Well, I'm talking about all these frequencies and resonances, are both heart and brain. Yeah. Well, that's what I was just saying. Our heart rhythms are the same as Earth, and our brain waves are the same as Earth frequencies. So when we're in a coherent state, we're more aligned with, and you increase the coupling between. In fact, I just got an email 2 days ago from our collaborator cardiology group at the University of Lithuania saying, we have new data. We've been looking at coherence. This is a very advanced group, by the way. I mean, they developed wild software for ECG analysis, all this crazy, I mean, really advanced stuff. And it's basically saying we're looking at morphological changes in the electrocardiogram, and when we're in a coherent state, and they're also looking at the magnetic field data. And he said, it looks like when we're in a heart coherent state, we increase coupling to the Earth's magnetic field. You already knew this, right? Next line on his email. And I went, well, intuitively, but not experimentally. Please publish. You know, but anyway, that's kind of neat. Okay, so this next draft I'm going to have to give a little bit of background on. Now, we've done lots of studies now where people wear recorders for their HRV over long time periods. So with our partner in Saudi Arabia, they did a study where a group of women wore these recorders for 5 months, 24/7. It was supposed to be both men and women, but the men flaked out. It was the women who couldn't. Okay, go ladies.
And the Arabs, eh?
Then another study, that's to look at correlations and changes between the different frequencies in the Earth's magnetic field and our nervous system activity. A lot of stuff came out of that. I'm not going to share that today for the time. In another study, a group, I'm going to tell a little story here. So 10 people wore these recorders that you wear 24 hours a day. They wore them continuously for 30 days. So a group of 10 people wearing these recorders for 30 days. And the original purpose of the study was the same thing, to look at the correlations between changes in the activity of our nervous system, which is what HRV reflects, heart rate variability, and the geomagnetic solar background, gas and air correlations and all that. But that's not the surprise. The surprise came out of that study when, I'm not even sure why we did this, but basically our lab manager, Mike Atkinson is his name, synchronized the data, the HRV data, the heart rate data. They send people and just kind of average it together over a 30-day period. So let's pretend we're all, this group here, we're all wearing recorders, right? So what we're recording is our electrocardiogram, and we're measuring the time between heartbeats. And these people are spread across the state of California. It's not like we're all in the same office holding hands and, right? I mean, people are going about their normal lives, some in Southern California, some in Northern California, some in Boulder Creek, right? Going about our normal days, day and nights. So what do you think would happen if we took all of our heart data and just averaged it together? What would you expect to see?
Correlate.
Really? Well, I didn't hire you. Because we expected it'd be nothing, just all average out to nothing, right? I mean, you know, things in your heart rates between all these 10 people going about their day in different parts of the state. We expected nothing. Mine's high sometimes, while yours is low, all that just averages out. This graph you're seeing on the slide is what we actually found. What this shows is that the group heart rhythms are synchronized.
Did they know each other, Rollin?
Not in all cases. Some did, but not all.
So there was no other correlation for the group? They weren't connected in some way?
No, but they knew they were all...
Well, they knew they were wearing a recorder. They didn't know why, necessarily. Again, this wasn't the purpose of the study. This was an add-on at the end of it.
But it went to prove your theory about their correlation with the Earth, right?
Well, yeah, that's where I'm going.
Oh.
I'm telling you the story of how we got there. So basically, when we first saw this, we were like, well, I can't say what we really said. We were surprised. And when I showed this to various colleagues that actually know what this means, their jaws dropped and they, like, what? How the, same thing we said, can this be? I said, when you look more closely, they're synchronized at about a 2.5 day rhythm. It's a very slow rhythm, right? We should have, in hindsight, it really should have been obvious what you just said. The only thing that can really explain this is if, also, I'm going to use the word humanity now because I'm where I'm going, but at least our group of 10 people was synchronized to something external. That was much deeper and more profound than what anybody noticed before. Okay? And that happens to be the red line, which is technically called the time-varying magnetic field data. Time-varying magnetic field. This means the oscillating fields. So let me put that in people language. It's the stuff that overlaps with our heart rhythms and brain waves. The oscillating, the resonant frequencies. Not the static measurements that most people report. So, in fact, it ends up being a highly significant statistical feat, correlation. So, in other words, we're synchronized because we're synchronized to this magnetic field. And what's really neat about this for us is it's exactly the rhythms in the Earth's fields that our magnetometer, our global network of magnetometers, is designed to measure. And we're having to do this ourselves because there's lots of magnetometers in the world. NOAA, international cooperation has all these magnetometers around the Earth, but they don't measure this stuff. They measure the strength of the field. And they sample it once a minute. So all this fast rhythmic stuff, nobody has it. So we had to do this ourselves. But I wish we didn't. Right? That's not our main thing.
When you say it's highly correlated on the right, it looks like it's opposite.
Great. That's where I'm going. But over the 30-day period, it's a high correlation.
To statistical success.
Very high. All right, so what the heck happened? Good question.
Yeah.
It's where I was going next. So you guys are very intuitive.
Right.
So if you look here, wait a minute, our group is synchronized still. Their HRV is going up, which is a good thing typically, but the magnetic field data plummets. What the heck? Well, as life would have it, there was a large, see that thing, the line where it says X flare? Can you see it? There was a large solar storm, a coronal mass ejection that happened, and just happened to be in the middle of our 30 days, or towards the 11. Okay, so now when we look at what's going on, the red line that I've added now is a thing called solar radio flux. So as it turns out, the sun radiates a radio wave that's 2.8 gigahertz, really fast, really high frequency. And some people actually model the resonant frequency of DNA at around 2.8 gigahertz. By the way, just as a side note.
Good side note.
And so this is radio wave, it's speed of light. So when there's a solar flare, this is also increased along with UV and X-ray and stuff. And it gets here in 8 minutes. Very fast. So what we saw, and by the way, back remember when I told you about that other study, the psychological study, mental clarity and all that? In that study with 1,600 people, it's the first place we found that when the measurement of this is called F107, it's the wavelength of 2.8 gigahertz. Not that you care about that. But anyway, when that increasing, people felt better. They were more mentally clear, slept better, all this positive stuff. So what we see here is once the red line, the F107, the solar radio wave stuff goes up, so does the group's heart rate variability. Okay, which is a good thing. So wow, now we've got physiological data and psychological data saying the same thing. Now after the solar flare, you've got all this turbulent solar wind and particles coming, but it takes 3 days to get here. Even at 1,000,000 miles per hour, it still takes it 3 days. So that's the blue line. And as soon as it hits, the Earth's magnetic field gets all disturbed and the plummets. And the group's HRV plummets. And they go out of synchronization for a few days. And then at the very end, I wish we'd have had, if we didn't had known this, we'd have kept recording, obviously, right? But then they start coming back into synchronization at the very end.
Why wasn't this study done again?
Why wasn't this study done again? It was.
Because for a minute there, when you said, I wish we would have done it.
I wish we'd have kept, had we known that we had a solar flare and all this was going on, we'd have kept recording. But you know, we didn't know this until after the fact, right? So anyway, this is pretty profound stuff with some pretty wide-ranging implications. So the next question became, well, can we replicate this? And is the big question was, okay, this is cool. This is happening in California. Is this happening globally? So the next study, got fortunate to get some funding to do this from a foundation. So the next study had a little over 100 people. And there were groups of 20 in each group in 5 countries. So here's some photos of some of our groups, New Zealand, Lithuania, California, Saudi Arabia, and actually England as well participated. So this crowd wore these recorders again for 2 weeks, all at the same time. So 100 people, all around radically different time zones, right? Like we're 10 hours different than Saudi Arabia and 8 from England and so on. So this is the data, and I apologize for complicated looking graphs. Let me explain what these mean. So this is the global data. So this is the HRV and Earth magnetic field data being plotted together for the group globally. And what we see here, SRP means human resonance power. Okay, so the brainwave stuff is, this is one subgroup. So we've got one group that is highly synchronized together, who is in sync with the human resonance power. As it goes up, their HRV goes up. As it goes down, their HRV goes down with an amazing degree of correlation. I mean, again, jaw-dropping. This is globally. Okay, even though you're in radically different time zones. Okay, now, another out of the 100 people, another type of group, also synchronized together, is this group over here. Okay, so the red is the HRV and the black is the human reference power. So the black lines are identical in the two graphs. Now this group is exactly the opposite. They're synchronized together, but responding exactly opposite of the other group. So if human resonance power goes up, their HRV goes down, where the other group went up, and vice versa. Okay? And then there's a third group that wasn't synchronized to anything, each other or the Earth's fields, in a smaller group. And that's not the group you want to be in. Okay, does everybody, you have any questions here? Because this is kind of profound if you get what I'm saying here.
Are we going to get to the part where we find out why they're different?
I have no idea what they're different.
Really?
No, this is brand new data.
Wow.
This is you're the one of the first people to ever see this.
And the groups? Specified.
Which group was out of sync?
What do you mean?
Which group?
Well, these are people spread across, there's globally. It's not like a group in Saudi Arabia was these.
Oh.
These are 100 people. Yeah. No, it's all 100 people being recorded exactly the same time.
So what you're saying is that even though some might be on the other side of the Earth and all of the sun is coming in, they were in sync or not in sync, but you don't know what?
Well, I'm saying that there's three subgroupings of humanity.
And it has nothing to do with the sun.
Well, okay. Yes, it does. Indirectly. Yes, it has to do with the sun.
Yeah, but how the...
Okay, so the sun's driving a lot of these processes.
Yeah, and all the springs and all the...
Yeah. But basically, in response to the Earth's magnetic environment, I'm saying there's three... If we look at across... Because we can generalize this in humanity now.
Okay.
Right? So we're saying there's three types. One group that's positively correlated, a group that's negatively correlated, but highly, but those two groups are synchronized together.
And it has nothing to do with their position.
It has nothing to do with where are they on Earth.
No.
So people in Saudi Arabia are in sync with people in California, and New Zealand, and England. Okay? And then you have a third group who's not synchronized to anything, that are decoupled, that are separated from the Earth's real environment and each other.
Was there a study about their age?
Okay, we got a lot of questions coming here.
They're not one place.
No, they're not. This is globally. Yeah, let me say it again.
They're sprinkled throughout the
global environment. Yeah, so you got some groups, some people in the Saudi group are positively and some are negatively. Some group in the England group, same way. Okay.
Do you have numbers? Like one third or one?
Yes, it's not quite one third. The decoupled group is the smallest of the groups. The positively correlated group is the largest, and the negatively correlated group would be the next. Okay, I'm gonna have a half hour hopefully here at the end for questions. Is that okay? Okay. All right, so now we're looking at cross globally to the ULF, the field line resonance data. It's what I just showed you, Schumann resonances. Voila. So we see global synchronization to the ULF rhythm as well, which is the largest group. Well, actually, it's not, I shouldn't say the largest group, because you can be synchronized to both rhythms, and a lot of people are. They're very different time scales. I hope that made sense. This is kind of complicated.
No.
The take-home message.
You think?
The take-home message. But the take-home message is that we are synchronized globally. Humanity is hearts are synchronized.
Except for the
what's
the advantage?
Hey, let me finish. Overall. Yeah, we are globally synchronized, because, and we're synchronized with each other because we are synchronized to the rhythms of the Earth's field. Right? And yes, there is a group that is decoupled, and we'll be trying to find ways to help them. I'm serious. Like the study I just mentioned, this from Lithuania, found that when people learn to get more coherent in their heart rhythms, they become more coupled.
Right, of course.
Right?
Third group.
Yes.
Are they the ones running things?
Well, we laugh, but who knows?
The friend of Roland who's in Germany, Berlin, is going to get to the bottom of that.
No, but in general, there's enough data coming in now, enough historical data, to strongly suggest that not being coupled to the Earth's field is not a good thing. For our own health, and certainly, I think, I would ask share for the global field environment as well. You know, the people are just out of sync.
Yeah.
So it's a really interesting question you asked. I mean, nobody knows, I mean, this is new stuff. The fact that we're even synchronized like this is totally unexpected. And we'll be, you know, we'll see how many, you know, I'll probably get accused of all kinds of things here for publishing this stuff. But it's very real and very strong data. Okay.
So, what were the criteria for selecting these people?
You were healthy.
You're healthy, that's okay. Because I was going to wonder when the guy joked, because I was joking about they must be politicians. Or
no. These the groups in Lithuania, the group in Lithuania
kids.
And the group in Saudi Arabia were medical students.
Okay.
They're studying to be doctors.
And even division of girls and boys?
I'm sorry?
Even division of girls and boys?
Yeah, even division of girls and boys. Both overall. We don't know. Yeah, it is amazing. We're not the first to see individual differences. I mean, we're the first that did groups at the same time like this. But there's a number of reports in the literature that have looked at HRV and geomagnetic storms and stuff that see that people respond, individual differences. Our Saudi study shows that very strongly. In fact, we published a paper just about how to measure individual differences. You know, kind of like that.
Roland, based on this, what are you inspired to do next for that kind of study?
I'm sorry, say it.
Based on the findings from this study, what are you inspired to do? You know what I mean? Because you keep saying this is brand new, you got me going, like, what next?
Well, I'm not sure what's next. We got to finish this. there's a lot more to this study than we've even analyzed yet. So for example, these 100 people at one point in the study all did a heart lock-in together at the same time. So we haven't even got to that yet, right? So we had people in the back room who had their hands up several times. So let me go back there.
What effect does this have on healing?
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I mean, this let it sink in what I've just said. We are synchronized. Humanity is synchronized at a deep and fundamental level with the earth. Let that soak in. There'll be a gazillion research questions that can come out of that. But.
Do you know, did anybody look to see when the Berlin Wall went down, what was going on?
I have no idea. We didn't have a system when the Berlin Wall went down. I'm not,
I'm gonna intervene for the people on the internet who can't hear your question.
Oh, good. I didn't know we had internet. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So what I want to do is, you want to go to continue on into questions? Why don't you go on through, and then let's do question time.
Perfect. I think that's
okay.
Better
can we hold your questions until we get to that? And then we can pass microphones, and everybody. Okay. There's people in the room can't hear you too. So.
Yeah. Great. I'm actually behind schedule, so I'm going to speed up a little bit. Sorry for that. I apologize in advance. So one of our hypotheses is that the Earth's magnetic fields carries biological information, right? And we affect the field. So this is a study. I'm going to go through it quickly. I'll summarize it by a guy named Luc Montagnier. Some of you may know that name. He won the Nobel Prize in medicine for discovery of the HIV virus. Guy that discovered AIDS. And he's a pretty cool scientist. He follows the data. And he's partnered up with a quantum physicist, another friend of mine who passed away recently. Last year, too bad. But anyway, they did an experiment that they ended up calling teletransportation of DNA. Now, the way this experiment worked is you've got these kind of lines here representing a magnetically shielded environment. Not as good as the one in Berlin, but they've done their homework at multiple levels to shield the magnetic environment. And inside of this box of magnetically shielded are two coils. One is a measurement coil, and one is a coil that you can add magnetic fields to the inside of the environment. And what they found is you put a test tube with DNA in it, that you could actually measure electromagnetic frequencies being radiated by the test tube with the DNA in it. That's pretty cool, but that's not revolutionary. Some other people have actually done that as well prior to that. Then, I'm going to skip part of the stuff because I'll get to the punchline. If you put a test tube of water with the constituents of DNA in it, not DNA, but just the stuff DNA is made out of, in the chamber, along with the test tube with the DNA in it, but separated, and if and only if you then stimulate that environment with a very low power magnetic field of 7.8 hertz, guess what happens? DNA forms in the second test tube that has a 98% base pair sequencing match to the test tube, the original test tube. Okay, this is pretty much done by a guy who's won a Nobel Prize, right? And he was able to get it published because of that. This was not popular when it got published. Right? In fact, I met with him not too long ago, and I almost got kicked out of the Nobel Laureate Club because of this. Right? Because this is validating things that, the mainstream science crowd does not care to see published.
His name again?
Luc Montagnier. And Emilio was the quantum physicist involved. I'm terrible with Italian names. Del Gussi, the slide before this, who's also a big proponent of Earth's magnetic field carrying information that connects the entire ecosystem. That's Emilio's. And there's all the math and quantum physics behind explaining it. He was really the genius behind this experiment. And there's other experiments like this. So maybe we're not so crazy to think that magnetic fields carry biological information. Right? Okay, now some of your might be aware of the Global Consciousness Project. So just if you're not, give you a little bit of background. Long history now, at least 40 years, of self-described quantum physicists, wacky quantum physicists, that's how they describe themselves. We're friends of mine, so they don't care if I say that. Found that things that are supposed to be random, fundamental laws of physics, like the decay rates of nuclear isotopes, random, right? Random decay rate. Stop being as random. Small but measurable in the presence of strong human emotions. Not mind intentions, emotions. Anyway, this led to lots of, you know, talks in secret about their findings over a glass of wine at conferences, and more people replicated it. And this led to the start of the Global Consciousness Project, which started at Princeton University probably 15 years ago now. And it's a worldwide network of random number generators that are very hardcore tested and designed to be random number generators. It's actually hard to do one. And so it's a global network all feeding data back to the same central server. And this is the data from that network during 9/11, the terrorist attacks in 9/11. So if everything's random, it'll just be around zero. This is the largest single effect ever measured on the network. And in fact, it deviated some hours before the actual first attack. And this data has been hammered on by skeptics and everybody else, and it's real data and independently confirmed. So they've done many, many experiments. It's been running for 15 years. So an example here of a global peace day. So I think it's September 21st, which now every September 21st is a global day when many different spiritual traditions, I think even Unity participates, GCI crowd on September 21st to pray and send good intentions to the world. So the blue line is a statistical line that if the red line crosses, it was a significant event. This is an example of one of many of such events. Been many, many hundreds of them now. So the statistics on this effect has now actually surpassed the statistical significance of quantum physics. It's p to the minus, minus 50 something now. I mean, it's huge. I mean, it's very, very real effect. So my favorite study that's been done by Dr. Nelson, Roger Nelson, who heads up the project, is this one. This is probably 2.5, maybe going on 3 years ago now. That they took what they call formal events, formal event being all this rigor, you had to predict it and do all this stuff ahead of time. About 180 of them at the time of this study. And you had a couple people independently rate these 180 events for their level of love and compassion. So like a global peace day, lots of love and compassion. Right? The medium bar, those would be events high with a lot of emotionality, but not a lot of love and compassion. So Super Bowl, World Cup, big sporting events, a lot of emotion, right? But not necessarily a lot of love and, you know, that kind of thing. And then low would be the emotional, again, highly emotional events, but those like for around a school shooting or things like that. And then, so I had them rated, and then independently, then averaged the response of the global network. And this is what you see, is that those in high love and compassion had a significantly greater impact on the global field environment as measured by this network than those in medium or low. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
Now, nobody knows the mechanism, right? So why in the heck are human emotions massively, when lots of people have the same emotion triggered, what about that is interfering with, or interacting is a better word, with a fundamental quantum process, which is what these red number generators are. They're actually tunneling of electrons through a little device. And so something is clear that it is doing it. There's no argument with that. And those in high in love and compassion have the biggest effect. So I think this kind of helps connect the dots for me in a certain way. I'm going to wait on that. So basically what I'm suggesting, is that we are more loving, more appreciative, kind, that we, at the individual level, are more coherent. Measurably, we know that. we are then radiating a more coherent magnetic field. We know that. We can measure that too. When we're more coherent, we are more aligned with, coupled with, the Earth's magnetic field. So we're increasing our coupling to it. And we see the effect, at least on these devices. Make sense? Well, at least that's something we can test. We proved all that yet. So I talked about this in the services earlier today. Basically, we're all coupled to the global information field. And it's wonderful when we come together, maybe once a week for a Sunday service, and get in the heart together and pump out love and compassion. But what are we doing the rest of the week? What are we feeding the field? Because we're always coupled. It's not like we're just coupled to the field when we're in deep prayer or meditation, or when we're feeling positive things. So how much of the time, what's the ratio of time that you really are genuine in the heart, loving, caring, being kind, versus feeding the field maybe with anxiety or fear or just plain pissed offness or right? That's a scientific term. Yeah, but you get my point, right? What's the ratio? So it's really about taking self-responsibility for what we're feeding the field. It's really what being a coherence field is all about. So it really starts at the individual level. And as more and more groups, so I love what's going on here at Unity, what David's done. I'm big honor of it. Because as more classrooms, communities, groups really work together, not just to build coherence, but to sustain it. That's what the Earth needs. That's what will eventually shift the field environment. So as more and more groups do this around the Earth, that's what moves us to social coherence. Because we're feeding the field, and that makes a stronger signal for others. So those that are in the process of waking up, of connecting with who they really are, it's a stronger signal. It helps. It makes it easier. Make sense? Right, so let's amplify and sustain that field. And as enough groups do that, the signal gets strong enough and sustained enough, stable enough, that then eventually moves us to global coherence. So there's lots of, I'm going to go through this quickly. We're also, as part of global interconnectivity, measuring trees, because all living systems are connected in. So we've been measuring tree potentials for some time now. So we got electrodes on a big redwood tree and a big oak tree. And this is 105 days. So the trees have very rich and very dynamic electrical lives. They have circadian rhythms and respond to other things. I wish I had more time because there's a whole other, maybe another time we'll do tree story. So here's the oak tree and the redwood tree in different kind of locations. Over 56 days.
Did anyone hug a tree during that time?
Oh, yeah, of course. Of course. Yes, is the answer. Good. I'm not going to go into that now.
Yeah.
This is the ULF trends in trees. So they're also plugged into the same environmental signals we are, ULF and the Schumann resonance stuff, and respond in different ways. So right now what we're doing is actually creating, well, let me back up. So you might be familiar with radio telescopes, where they have farms of them. So what you do is you have a lot of radio telescopes, you bring the signals into one place, and so you use a lot of antennas to amplify the signal. So you look at them as a whole, as one. So what we're developing right now is the way to do that with trees. So we'll be monitoring whole rows of trees and lots of trees spread out through certain forests, so we can look at the forest as one, to amplify those signals and be able to ask some other unique questions, like, are trees communicating energetically with each other? Well, yeah, I know, but it's just like I said in one of the services. We all know we're connected somehow. So let's see if we can't put some answers to the somehow, like, hey, no, it's real. I know, I love it. You're right, though, they are. And also, how do trees respond to humans? What's the interconnectivity between humans and emotions? Anyway, those are the questions we'll be asking with this new network. Roxy, so now I've got just a couple minutes here to this is the infomercial part of the day. So we do an annual event in Mexico. Should I go ahead and do this?
What's that?
Should I go ahead and do this? Should we wait?
Go ahead.
All right, so this is my funnest event to do of all the events I do around the world. This year is called Awakening Our Hearts and Intelligence, Activate the Intuitive Heart. It's in December, early December, December 7th through 11th. Myself, Howard Martin, and Debbie Roslin, the CEO of HeartMath, will be presenting at this. And basically, it's in Cancun, Mexican Riviera. It's a pretty cool place, especially in December. And the mornings, in the mornings, we do lectures. You know, so it's where I introduce, or the promise I always make is the latest GCI research. You get to hear about it here first.
Give incentive.
Well, it's not just, but I mean, it's kind of, this is really a GCI event. Last year we had people from 12 countries. Every year it's about like that. And I was telling you earlier, last year we had some folks in Afghanistan, and I was having lunch and said, well, who are you and why are you here? It was the Minister of Health from Afghanistan. Yeah, who I found out had been teaching heart math to all the ministers. I know, isn't that so cool?
That's cool.
Very cool. So anyway, you never know who's going to be there. And it's been every year's got a story like that. That's some fun thing. But anyway, the mornings are workshops, and the afternoons are free to go check out the Mayan ruins or swim with the dolphins or the sea turtles, that kind of stuff. It's where all the big sea turtles are. I mean, really, you just go off the beach and there's the sea turtles. And it's a private beach. And it's a pretty cool place. It's truly a five-star place, all-inclusive. So the photos look pretty cool, right? Uh-huh. My first year, I saw the photos, and I'm thinking to myself, airbrush. But it's one of the few places I actually, when I got there, it's actually better than what the pictures do.
Wow.
I mean, it's really a first-class thing in the jungle. The actual trainings are held at the Dow Center, which is actually, you're up in the canopy and of the jungle, the glass all the way around. Actually, you'll behold the event. And there's the Mayan ruins. Lots of stuff to do in the afternoons. There's the private beach. And so if you're interested, I would certainly invite anybody who would like a combination vacation and it's a four-day event. You know, so we do basic heart math on the first day, to stuff like I've been talking about today, of bone depth on the second day, then go into more advanced heart math tools and techniques that aren't part of our books and stuff on the last day, typically.
Finding your soulmate is on the agenda.
Finding your soulmate is not on the agenda. But learning to follow, but I will say, learning to align and follow your own heart's guidance, because what one of the biggest things, the reason we did the intuition research, is more and more people said, when I learned to follow my heart, my intuition is radically increased, and so is synchronicity. So your soulmate's only going to come from alignment and following who you really are. Yeah. I'll bet it happens that way more than it does on LinkedIn. Anyway.
So let me go ahead and let's take a love offering, and then we've got a while to we'll have microphones so we can hear each other as we get into our questions. So this is love offering. This is your way of acknowledging through your gift that how you value and acknowledge the wisdom that Roland's been sharing here. So I invite you to take it, take a moment, write out the check. If you want to do a credit card, there is an envelope on the little clipboard in the pocket in front of you. You can use a credit card. Make your check out to Unity. And we share of that with Roland. And we have when we enter into the experience of giving, we try to do that very, very consciously and put a lot of our love, coherence into that experience. So I invite you, as you're giving, just to take that deep breath through your heart. And let's feel our appreciation of Roland and the wonderful research and wisdom that he's doing, and all the people there at HeartMath who support this marvelous work and have brought it really to the world's attention. Just feel that appreciation. I invite you to join me in a simple feeling appreciation. I am so grateful. Join me.
I am so grateful.
Again.
I am so grateful.
And again.
I am so grateful.
And so it is. Amen. Okay, now, I would appreciate it if you've got a question, raise your hand. Garrett's got microphones for the back of the room there. And I'll try to give them to you here in the front.
Also wanted to note, David, that there are flyers for the Mexico event, I think in the bookstore or somewhere if you're interested in.
Yes.
You'll want to look up the website and learn more about it.
And love to see some of you there. Let me acknowledge, after we close here, the bookstore is open. You can go ahead and order the book. And remember, there's not only the heart intelligence, there's the new science of the heart. That Rollin brought us his first ones out. So that, I assume they can also get Science of the Heart on your website.
Sure.
So I do want to mention,
yeah, but get it
every
to
all of this is wonderful research is posted on the heartmath.org website, the HeartMath Institute.
And by the way, any donations that I, whatever I, however we split, just don't go to me. They'll go directly to support the HeartMath Institute to support research.
I just wanted to mention that somebody left the blue sweater outside on the patio.
There
you go. So go ahead, are we on?
Hello?
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. McCraty. It was a wonderful talk. I really appreciate you spending your time here with us today.
I forgot to talk to you.
Quick question. I don't know if you're familiar with the 1993 study where 4,000 meditators were brought to D.C. to try and locate. How does, just for everyone's information, 4,000 people were brought there to meditate to try and lower the crime rate that summer. How does this effort relate to that, and how's it different from that? And what it did, they had a statistical significance of a drop of 23% in violent crime for the next 3 months.
Yeah, that type of work has been replicated multiple times, not just the D.C. study as well. Two things. Well, first of all, on those types of studies, all of them that I'm aware of anyway, as soon as the meditator stopped meditating, the crime rates or the violence or the war activities in the different studies went back to their baseline levels. So it only worked while they were meditating.
Yeah.
So there wasn't really what we call a baseline shift, which is really kind of what we're hoping with GCI, kind of a different perspective there. But what we're measuring here, I suspect, I try not to make predictions because they're usually wrong and we find something in the cooler. But it's pretty true. What we're investigating here, I believe, could be the potential mechanism that explains that.
Okay.
Something has to connect us. See, I don't believe in magic. I really don't. And I'm actually a skeptic, but I'm not a cynic. Big difference. In other words, something like the mother who knows their child's in trouble on the other side of the planet. Something has to connect that. Same thing, the meditator, something has to be putting something into the field that affects the consciousness of the others. I'm just suggesting that there's a very real possibility that is magnetic field of matter. So it's possible, and it's something we can measure. Make sense?
Over here.
My question is whether or not you have any data that shows whether global coherence is increasing as we move forward in time. Is it getting more coherent or less coherent?
Yeah, we don't have data yet, other than what you look at in the news, right? Which does not look good. Which does not look good. There's some good TV going on right now. If you watch the drama, reality TV in real life, but. No, but we're actually working on some measures right now. I've got actually a couple guys that are way smarter than me trying to take our magnetometer data and coming up with a new measure of global coherence for the field environment. Because right now we only have measures of disturbance, and called KP index, for those of you know that. And KP index, by the way, does not correlate. That's why almost all the research in the past in terms of hospital admissions and bad stuff have been based on KP index, disturbed fields. And what we're seeing is it hardly correlates at all with the HRV data. So they didn't have the kind of data we have, because nobody, all they had was disturbance data. They didn't have this high resolution data of what's really going on in the magnetic field, what overlaps with us. We're the first system to ever do that. So I hope that there's a lot more to that.
We've got a question here.
Who has the microphone?
Right.
Oh, okay.
Talk to me. Great. And being a 14-year Army veteran, biking desert storm and all that, I've really noticed a change. Back then, I was in a Baptist philosophy and right and wrong with the intention of love. But since I've started coming to unity and open-mindedness, and especially heart math, facilitating the group for 2 years, it really transitioned me. And so the question is, in your studies, has it been proposed to, because I myself have been practicing this, where I intentionally get coherent and send, whenever, especially when there's a report of ISIS doing this or that, to envelop everyone there with genuine love from my heart, not from my head. And I'm wondering if there may be a study that would encourage, especially those of us who are coherent practitioners in other countries, to do that for those who in the society identify as other people, like over there they identify America as Satanist, and to do that as a portion of the healing mechanism. I'm feeling a definite shift in my awareness when I intentionally wrap love around someone who's just done something against other people.
Cool. Well, first, thank you for your service. I'm actually from myself, so
awesome.
Vietnam era. But there's not currently a study that's exactly doing that, but we have done some, like the interconnectedness study for GCI members.
Yeah.
So will be studies coming up. We're putting actually a new focus on this, some of what we're seeing. So if you'd like, I'm looking for new studies to have the GCI community, the membership, participate in and be more engaged like we did. So if you're a GCI member, if you're not, and you would like to be involved in something like that, be a member. It doesn't cost anything. You can donate if you want to, but so sign up to be a member, and then whatever notices come, God loved it. And we're doing a lot of other veteran-related stuff, by the way. If you're interested, you go to our site. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of stuff for the community. So,
hi, my name's River.
I just I don't know very much about heart math, really, but I've been hearing a lot about grounding, like grounding mm-hmm. blankets,
yeah,
and things like that.
Okay, I don't know if it has, y'all heard the question. I don't know if it has anything to do with being incoherent, but it is a real thing. So I heard about the books on grounding and Jim Oshman, who's a big champion of it, a friend of mine. So the first thing that I did is we brought some people in the lab and stuck a ground rod in the ground and a current meter in between them and the person, and sure enough, we can measure current flow. So it's a real thing. We are isolated from ground. And the theory behind it makes a lot of sense. To a certain degree, basically electrons flow from the earth into us and helps, reduce inflammatory processes and things like that. It is real when you put people in. So some of those studies I've seen on them are nonsense. I mean, from the perspective, they weren't well done. But however, I was involved in one with Dr. Hallberg in a family, three generations of people that are extremely sensitive to magnetic disturbances. Grandma, mother, and then the granddaughter, which is rare, by the way. I mean, most of us aren't that. It's about 10% of the population seems to be sensitive from a health perspective. But anyway, one of the things that they tried was grounding them, and it actually had a measurable difference in their cortisol and outcomes and things like that. So anyway, walk barefoot now and then. You don't have to necessarily buy the sheets.
Go ahead.
Okay, question. Yeah. I don't know if you can answer this one or not, but I was interested in wondering if you were talking about being in your heart and sending love. And your meditation, the talk on, or the discussion on the group that did the meditation in Washington, and it dropped the crime level, but it came back up after it was over. If you wrap the world in love while something is going on, I can see the effect on, enough people do that, on the field. But if you, when that is over, you move on to something else and there's not something going on, that where you're not sending out that kind of energy, is there a lasting effect? Do you have any idea if there's a lasting effect on that where it raises the consciousness? And what happens if we stay ourselves in a state of coherence and love, but we're not necessarily working on a particular group?
Right, right. Those are great. Multiple questions woven in there. Really.
Welcome to Unity.
Welcome to Unity. Let me start by saying one of the things that Doc Childre, our founder of HeartMath, has said since day one, 30-some years ago when I met him, is love is never wasted. Just don't be looking over your shoulder all the time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise that's bringing the mind in, but love really is never wasted. And I have become to be a firm believer of that. That is absolutely true. So maybe that's kind of the global answer, real easy right off this, Dan. A lot of my writings and a lot of our research is about, or one segment of it, is about what we call shifting your baseline. Mm-hmm. And which means that if you really increase consciousness and sustained it enough, increased our vibratory rate, is another way I talked about it earlier today, to where it's become our new state, right? And that takes time and some effort, right? And that actually, I would suggest, also leads to epigenetic changes as well, when it really becomes a new baseline and stabilized. So as enough people do that, the effects don't go away. We've actually raised our, what color, the end result is it does increase our consciousness. But it's also increasing a lot of other stuff, including what we're feeding the field without having to think about it. Mm-hmm. And so I can talk about meditation. I did it for 15 years plus before I met Doc and then HeartMath. Still meditating, there's more lock-ins now. And so I could, you know, have a great meditation, man. I could be zooming around and I could be with an energy through the heart chakra and da-da-da. And get up and get just as mad as could be before I got to work because of the traffic jam and what, right? Yeah. My baseline was not shifted. Make sense?
Yeah.
I'm trying to, it's kind of a roundabout answer, but as we're able to really shift our baseline, we don't have to be walking around, what am I feeding the field? That's really when it becomes really meaningful. We're not trying to use mind intention, but it's just us. It's the what we're vibrating. It's our state of being. And when enough people are doing that, that's when we get a field shift.
Yeah.
That's succinct.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Alexandra. Mine is a twofold question.
Imagine that.
We are in the Earth's global field. And there's a magnetic field that connects us to us, all of us here. Are there any measurements that have been done to connect us with other universes coming from other planets? Mm-hmm. And is there research done in us connecting with other dimensions, and especially coupling with the divine?
I'm surprised you didn't throw in a who made God. Well, you said you may not have meant to say coupling with other universes. So I'm not sure. Are there other? I mean, that's a wacky theory in my opinion. I mean, at least one universe that we know of.
Right.
But in other planetary systems and things. There's some. It's not. I haven't looked at it. There's only so much time in a day. But certainly their moon and things like that have measurable effects on the field and that kind of thing. What was the second part of your question?
The measurement of dimensions.
Dimensions, yes, dimensions.
And the divine.
And the divine. So I, so in some of the books, HeartMath books, I'm going to go off scientific proof for a second here, like Hidden Power of the Heart, one of those especially. talked a lot, and Doc Childry talks a lot about dimensions. So we have to be careful there because there's different types of dimensions we can talk about. You know, so there's time, space, you know, those kind of dimensions. Dimensions of density, another time type of that I think about, like speed of lights and speed of density and all that kind of stuff. And then dimensions of consciousness. So I think dimensions of consciousness is what you're talking about.
Yes.
So, and everybody has to come to their own conclusion and own belief here, but I'll give you my own personal perspective, is that what I've been referring to throughout the day is soul and spirit is very real structure, just in another dimension. That actually happens to also be another dimension of density. Less dense. Okay, but real, and real structure. And it's the heart in the human body that couples to that other dimension. Mm-hmm. And when we're more coherent in this body and dimension, it increases our coupling to that. So again, information from that part of ourself is the flow of that intuition from spirit is what we call intuition. And I'm not talking about the kind of intuition that a lot of people covet. Can I see through a deck of cards in Las Vegas? I'm talking about the real stuff that unfolds who you really are. It connects us with that. And I would also suggest Earth experience is what it's all about. There's learning to be in this level of density, yet reconnect with that other part of who we really are. So I hope I answered your question. I can't prove that in the lab yet. But I will say, I have never said this publicly before, but there is a small group of scientists that formed a few years ago, and we call ourselves the Spirit Team. And our goal is to prove the existence of the human spirit. I'm not sure we'll pull it off. And that would be, if it ever gets pulled off, whoever does it win, I think will be the most significant, important discovery in human history. But it'll put to rest all this nonsense about self-organized, blah, blah, blah. But, yeah.
I have the microphone. I paid last summer $7,000 to Dr. Amen's clinic over in Brisbane to have help me heal some of the traumas that I've had. Has some of your studies by any chance been coordinated with their efforts?
Yeah, I just did a course of Dr. Amen's top doctors a couple weeks ago. And they're all getting M-Wave Pro Pluses to assess heart coherence in all their patients from this time forward. And we'll be actually slowly but integrating HeartMath training into their clinics.
Did you reach out to them?
I'm not sure how we met, but I've known Dr. Amen for years.
Thank you, Daniel.
Huh? Daniel, yeah.
Here's a question here.
Hi. I really appreciate the presentation. I found it so insightful. My question relates to the massive amounts of extinction we're seeing with species, our planet's degradation, the Great Barrier Reef is bleaching. Mm-hmm. How does that impact either our field or our basic lack of good stewardship of the planet? Mm-hmm. Like, what impact is that having on us and vice versa?
Oh, boy. So I can't answer that from a science-proof perspective, mm-hmm. but just to say that if I'm right, what I have said, that all living systems are interconnected through the global field environment, it's damn important.
Yeah. Yeah.
And certainly some species. You know, and my personal, we'll call it belief on that, would be we need to make sure that the trees are taken care of, dolphins, sea turtles, and whales. Because
yeah.
They hold a baseline level of awareness that we have no clue of. That actually helps uplift even humanity. And bees, and I would add bees to that. You're absolutely right. I meant
elephants.
Yeah.
And elephants.
Yeah. Okay, but we can go on and on. But there's certainly
no.
Yes. They're all
very
bombs.
In regards to your spirit team, mm-hmm. Michael Murphy at Esalen has a think tank going where they're exploring the possible origins of the Big Bang and mm-hmm. theorizing that it's
good.
That I just see. Collaboration possibility.
Yeah, possible.
But no, the theory they're putting out is that possibly what gave rise to the whole universe was love, mm-hmm. the vibration of love, mm-hmm. which then makes sense to me when we the one graph where compassion rates the highest, mm-hmm. that if that's true, it's because we're most, that's most in sync with the originating vibration of the universe.
Makes sense to me. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm just glad to hear that.
And thank you.
I have a question about healing. It seems to me that if you get a group together that are coherent and they do healing on another person, that, of course, that's going to be more effective. So what I'm seeing, though, is that it doesn't maintain. The energy that you develop or build in this healing, if when you stop, it dissipates, it seems to me. But but I do have a question, and I know you're familiar with Greg Braden, and he tells the story of the woman in China who had a tumor, and three women stood over her and love, and the tumor went away.
Right.
It seems to me that this is connected somehow.
Okay. Science hat off again. And I'd say there's actually an increase, although there's some certain actual, I'm not a conspiracy type guy, by the way. I'm just not. But there are certain suppressions of certain types of things that are real. And one of those is the increase in what's typically called spontaneous healing. That's actually increasing. More of that going on. And as part of the shift in consciousness going on, part of that, the manifestation of that is that increase. And there's lots of other signs of it. And that's simply as people's spirits are starting, or soul spirit energies are working closer with them. It has its consequences too. Stuff feeds back a lot faster, right? Because it's time to wake up as a species. It's what the shift's all about. It's a consciousness shift through my eyes. Okay? Don't believe me, don't trust me, I'm just sharing my perspective. Okay, so what if, let me say it this way. What if we really do have spirits, souls and spirits, and we choose to come down here to Earth into this increased dimension of density to learn things? And as we do that down here, we grow up there too. What if it really is that way? And what if we choose, as part of our lessons this time around, to have cancer? Or whatever. All the healers praying over you in the world is not going to change that. Nor should it. I hope you get where I'm going. That's our blueprint. Now, having that facility of energy might help us make peace with, go through the process with more ease and grace, right? But to actually make the cancer go away in this example would actually be a disservice to our greater healing and our greater. So what if it's that way? And what if other people, you know, they get into trouble health-wise because they're really not following their blueprint? You know, it really can be that way too. And in that case, a higher consciousness really can help facilitate a lower consciousness back to healing. But if they don't wake up and start making some changes, it pops out somewhere else or over here because they haven't really dealt with the malalignment that's causing the play out to begin with. Make sense? Yeah, so don't believe me. Just what if? What if exercise?
I, you know, kind of thinking when I'm listening to you that there's nothing new. So when we think of like civilizations that really were connected with the sun and the moon and the universe, that they were more intuitive. So my question is about astrology, which is an ancient science. And we know that we've just been through a couple of eclipses and some, you hear about planets in retrograde, and that's all energy too. So what about our solar system and all this?
Yeah, what's the question here?
So do you feel like that's connected as well? Like what happens with our planets and our solar system? I saw the magnetic field around the Earth, but what about the energy in our solar system? Because planets move forward and backwards.
Sure.
And
well, they don't really move backwards. But
well, retrograde, yeah, okay.
But anyway,
backwards, yes.
Yeah, well, I mean, let's also keep in mind that the sun has a really big magnetic field that all the planets are within. mean, the solar, the magnetic field of the sun embraces every, all, even including Pluto.
Yeah.
So we're all within the magnetic field of the sun.
So we're all related.
And all the stars that we see out there are suns that have really big magnetic fields. And we now are starting to know that there are current flows between all the stars and all the, I mean, it's a really big, complex universe. And anyway, so it's all interconnected.
It's all connected.
It's all connected.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This is so enlightening. So I've been a member of our prayer team for a while, and I go through a morning prayer ritual where I do a heart lock-in, and then I send heart love to different populations. And one that I've felt in my heart lately, felt the compassion for, was foster children and how they're treated. So I started including foster children in my morning prayer about maybe 2 weeks after that, after I started that. I happened to glance at a paper somewhere, the headlines, and it said that the California, you know, legislature was seriously reviewing measures to clamp down on medical doctors who were over-prescribing to foster children. Oh. So I remember thinking, whoa, maybe I'm making a difference here. Now, there's probably a lot of other people praying for the foster kids, but I really felt like, yeah, I'm making a difference, and how we can all make a difference with sending out that love.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so just wanted to share that.
Oh, thank you. Love is never wasted, right? Yeah.
How does your research interface with...
You have to... Hold that for us to hear. Thank you.
How's your research interface with work done with biorhythms for so many years?
Yeah. What do you mean by biorhythms is kind of a vague term to me.
Well,
what
there's physical biorhythms, there's mental or emotional biorhythms.
Okay, so the
mental biorhythms, there's emotional biorhythms.
Yeah.
The interface with our physiology and our consciousness.
Yeah. I don't know. In terms of that model, we've never really looked at the different type of biorhythms. Certainly, in fact, to mention this earlier, we actually developed a resilience program for the Navy. But so as part of that whole program, we talked about
different types of...
Different types of... So we have a literal mental energy, emotional energy, relational energy. There are real different distinct types of energy that have rhythms in them. Now, it's not the traditional biorhythm where you part your charts and all that stuff, but it's a real measurable kind of energy that we can deplete and renew. And so getting coherent really charges our inner battery and, you know, yeah.
Go ahead, Richard.
That third group.
What?
That third group, the ones that not sinking.
Okay.
You're saying they're sprinkled throughout, in one place, but they're sprinkled out. Brand new data, you haven't isolated or haven't further qualified.
I don't know why.
But that would be kind of relevant, don't you think?
You don't want to
be in that group, which is, why not? I mean, not good or like.
What, you're asking why is it not good to be in that group?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, one reason is that it's more and more evidence, actually there's actually a lot of evidence for this, but is that we, when one looks at it through new eyes, but some of the new studies from Lithuania, is that we, the Earth's magnetic field is literally a source of energy. And when we're coupled to it, it charges that inner battery to a certain degree. Not just the food we eat, there's other types of energy. But this is starting to show out in a kind of a real way that can be measured. So lack of coupling means you're missing an energy source. Right, so you don't have that same energy to maintain our vibrational pitch, to lift consciousness. You know, so I think that group is also decoupled from humanity in the global field environment. They're just out of sync. So, yeah. I mean, that's a hypothesis right now. But why the three groups? We don't have a clue. In fact, we just found out there are three groups. But it's a really fascinating question as to why, what is different about those people? Is it physiology or what, you know?
One more question. Okay. Last question right there.
Last question.
I just wanted to know, are you going to continue that study to find out why there were those differences?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure we will.
And is that published, if you're a member, where you could see the...
Well, yeah, I'm so far behind on publishing. Okay. Right now I've got three studies I'm trying to get written up on just the stuff we're talking about here, some of it. I don't know who, I mean, I'm certainly going to motivate and suggest that question be asked. It probably won't be me, but it'll probably be one of our collaborators, you know, like the Lithuanian group, maybe or maybe not. But yeah, it's an important question.
All right,
that was the last question, huh?
So that's the last question. So the assignment is get everybody, get our pitch up.
Okay.
We got it?
All right.
Okay. That's, and Rollin, thank you so much for being with us. So Rollin will be in the book center. Those of you that got books, or if they've got some of the HeartMath books left, Rollin will be there to sign books, and then we're going to let him get home.
Oh my God.